Well, welcome to Discovery Church. Man, God is here today. Can I get an amen? Amen. I hope you're expecting to hear from God. My goodness, His presence is so powerful today. Hey, before I jump into the message, we have our small groups launching next week. So in front of your seat, you should see in those pockets a Discovery Group pamphlet, little brochure. We have 42 groups for you to choose from this season. Yeah, that's the most ever we've had. Groups for all ages, all the way from kinder to, you know, 50-plus groups. So, and all in between, you guys. So the groups start next week. Find a group that's right for you. There's a couple different ways you can do that. You can check these groups out during the service, after the service. There's a number by the group. You can grab a connection card, fill it out, and put that number on the bottom of the card, and we'll get that information to the leader. Someone will follow up with you about that group and connect with you. You can also go online. You can sign up online on the app, even the Discovery Church app. There's even a table in the lobby. If you want more information and talk to someone face-to-face, go to the small group table out there. So for the next week, pray, look, and jump into a discovery group, you guys. We had like 200 people register for small groups already at our group link event. So if you missed that, it's okay. You got a little bit over a week now to discern and decide what is the right group for you. So I hope you guys take advantage of those 40-plus groups. Today is the last message in this series we're calling Detox, and it's day 22. How many know what I'm talking about? Day 22. Come on. So we made it. We made it. We've been fasting for 21 days and going through this detox process to begin 2017, because if anything is really going to sabotage us and thwart the plans that God has for us, even the plans we set for ourselves, every year we have these great goals. It's usually not the things that happen to us as much as it is the things that are inside of us that are sabotaging. It's self-sabotage that happens, why we don't accomplish our goals and our dreams and especially God's purpose for our life. And so what we've done in this detox series is we've attempted to identify the areas in our life that have gotten a little bit toxic. And it's not just our bodies. You have three parts of you. We've been talking about in this series the three parts of you, what make you you. Everyone is created with three parts. So in part one, we talked about the spirit man and the spirit part of you. That's from time to time, we could actually, there's some things in this world that can affect, that can poison, that can just get inside of our spirits and affect our strength of our spirit man. So we talked about that. How do we strengthen, identify some of the toxins there, and then strengthen the spirit man, which is the eternal part of you. That's the eternal part of who you are. Now, part two was the soul toxins and the soul part of you, which is your emotions. That's where you get your feelings. That's where you get your mental capacity. And so we dug in there and said, okay, where have we allowed maybe our feelings and our emotions to become toxic or poisonous? And we did a soul detox of the negative emotions and the doubt and things like that. If you miss any of these messages in this series, really encourage you, kick off the new year right. Align body, soul, and spirit with God and His Word. Man, this will be the best year of your life if it's the best year of your life spiritually. And so that's what we've been trying to do here, is just make sure this is the best year of our life spiritually. So today, we're ending the detox series with the third part of who you are, the body. And so the body is not the most important part. It's the part we all see. It's the part we all talk about a lot. And even in the goals that we're setting this year, a lot of them have to do with the body and things like that. But I want to go a little bit deeper than what you might be thinking of body toxins today. Okay, let me open up again with our theme verse. For anyone who's new, this is our theme verse, 2 Corinthians chapter 6. And this is where Paul says, do not be yoked together. Do not be yoked together. And that Bible word, again, that's the word for that wooden instrument with two holes in it that go around oxen. And the oxen would plow a field for the shepherds side by side. It kept them close, so that they can plow the field straight. So what Paul is saying in the Bible here is be careful what you're close to. Be careful what you're tied to, and you can't help but like be around the world and be in the world, but you can help how close to the world you get. So that's what he's saying. Just watch the closeness. Watch the level of closeness that you're yoked together with the things of this world. For what do righteousness and wickedness have in common? Or what fellowship can light have with darkness? What harmony is there between Christ and this devil or demon Belial? What does a believer have in common with an unbeliever? And the answer to all those is like, there should be nothing. There should be no commonality between those things. What agreement is there between the temple of God and idols? For we are the temple of the living God. So this is God's case for this. He's saying, don't get too close to that stuff because I want to get close. That affects how close I can get. That's God's case. I don't want you to get close to that stuff because I want to be that close in your life. And as God has said, I will live with them. So God's saying, I want to be close. So if you allow those things to be close, it's going to affect how close I can get with you. He says, I will live with them and walk among them, and I will be their God.
And they will be my people. Therefore, and here's the solution. He says, therefore,
come out from that. Detox. You need to separate. Come out from that stuff that you've gotten close to and be separate. Like, create some separation, says the Lord. He says, touch no unclean thing. Like, don't get so close to it, and I will come close to you. I will receive you, is what he says. So maybe you didn't realize this, but you have a role to play in the degree of closeness that you get with God. So you have a role to play. It's not just God who needs to draw to you. Like, we have a role to play in the level of intimacy, in the level of closeness that we get with God. He says, I'll be a father to you, and you'll be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty. And then the next verse gives us the prescription that we've been exercising over these last several weeks. He says, since we have these promises that God wants that spot, God wants that closeness spot, since we have the promise that if we separate from that, God will come close, this is what he says. Since we have that promise, dear friends, let us purify ourselves. Let's identify some areas that have gotten contaminated, and let's separate ourselves. Let's purify it from everything that contaminates body and spirit, perfecting holiness out of reverence for God. So that's what we've been trying to do. And today we're going to jump into these body toxins. And there are some obvious body toxins that come to mind, like alcoholism or things you can ingest, drugs or smoke or whatever, that type of stuff. Sometimes people think, especially in this time of year, like your weight, that's the kind of thing that we think about with our body. Am I healthy or not? And, I make some goals as well with the way with weight and stuff, you know. Only God can create Krispy Kreme. How many know amen, huh? But only the devil will make me eat a dozen of them, you know. But I have the gift of eating. You guys can't tell because I wear it well. I know I do. But I love to eat. I love me some food and some donuts and some pizza and all that good stuff. And so I made a list of some things I'm going to eat today. I want to lose, you guys. I have a goal, like one of my goals, and I make different goals for the different areas of my life every year. I just kind of examine some things and see where I got off track and make some new goals. And there always is a realignment process that happens. And so I do, but weight is one of them. I want to lose 20 pounds this year. I want to lose 20 pounds, man. So here we are 22 days into it, and I got 22 more pounds to go. I'm working. It's hard, huh? It is hard. It's just difficult sometimes. The doctor told me, Jason, you're the perfect weight. You're the perfect weight. You're just 6 inches too short. So I'm working on that too, trying to stretch stuff, It does. It gets difficult. But today I want to do something. I want to go further than the superficial thoughts that we may have when it comes to the body toxins. And this is going to be a challenging word today, and the toxins that I'm going to share. But today I want to do something way beyond that weight. First, let me show you how the way you treat your body is affecting the other two parts of you. Do you know that? Like how the way that you treat your body can actually affect your spirit. The way that you treat your body can affect your soul, your emotions, your feelings. So it's important, and God actually says it's important. Look here in Romans chapter 7 with me, starting at verse 21. Paul is saying here, I find this law at work, and all of us can relate to this. He says, when I want to do good, evil is right there with me. For in my inner being, like, I want to do good. There's a good person inside of me that wants to make good choices and think good thoughts, and there's a part of me that even delights in God's law, he says, but the problem is, there's a war going on inside of me. There's a battle, there's a struggle, and it's affecting my spirit and my soul, but it began in my body, is what he says. But I see another law at work in the members of my body waging war against my soul, against the law of my mind, which means that the body can really impact the rest of you. And some of you feel that war. You're in the middle of that war. You feel the struggle of your body pushing you around, of your body pushing your spirit man away. Where you have this inside of you, this desire to do good. And the desire to is there, but there's a war that's being waged in your mind. And look at this. He says, it makes me a prisoner. So the life I'm living, it's not even the life I want to live. I feel like I'm trapped. This message is dedicated to all those who would say, I know what I want to live like, but I end up living like this. Like, I want my life to look like this, but I feel like I'm a prisoner of the law of sin at work within my members. That's your body. And then he just beats himself up a little bit. The Apostle Paul sounds frustrated in this moment here, in this process that's happening. He says, what a wretched man I am. He's like, I'm such a jerk. I mean, Paul, you're, why are you this way? Who will rescue me? And this is the question we're going to ask today. Who will rescue me from this body of death? Now, you may have never thought about your body causing that in your life, like your body actually causing a death experience inside your life. But if you have a detox of the things that are contaminating your body, I promise you, you're going to experience freedom in a brand new way. You're going to experience so much life and so much freedom. And I'll just be very honest with you that what I'm going to share with you today is it's real serious. All these are very real, very painful, and to some degree, they aren't fun to talk about. I've been praying all week about these areas that I'm going to be discussing with you today. It's not fun to address these things, but they have to be addressed because the Bible addresses them. Extensively, the Bible talks about these things. And my real goal today is not to point out areas of your life at all. That's not my goal. My goal is to help you find some freedom. That's what my goal is. So right off the bat, can I just say, my name is Jason. I'm your friend. I'm here to help you. Okay? I am. There's just, I love you, and I'm here to help you. But we need to address these things. We need to address some of these toxins in our body that are affecting our life. They're impacting our soul. They're impacting our spirit. So, and what it is, I'm going to kind of take it up a notch every time. Let me give you three toxins that you probably wouldn't think would be body toxins, but I'm going to give you three of them, and every one I'm going to take it up a notch and up a notch and go up a little bit deeper and a little bit further. So write this down. Here's the first one. If you're taking notes, jot it down. The first one is addiction. It's a body toxin. Addiction. So how many of you would say in this room, you'd say, yep, that's me. I'm addicted. I'm an addict. Yeah, see, me and three of you. You know what I'm saying? No one wants to agree that they're addicted. There's only a few of us that really know that the real definition of addiction is that I keep doing things that I don't want to do. Now that's all of us, right? Now we're all, yep, that's me. We're all in that same boat. Well, Jason, how do I know if I'm an addict? Do you try to keep it a secret? Do people tell you you have a problem? Does it isolate you from other relationships? And worse yet, if asked to stop, could you stop for 6 days? Or are you sweating right now just thinking about it? You know what I'm saying? Don't you take that away from me. No, I mean, the truth is all of us have to face addiction of some form. We all have some area that's basically telling us how to live. And that's why I just want to start right here and just say, what's in your life that shouldn't be there? I mean, it could be a host of things. It could be alcoholism. It could be lust. It could be gambling. It could be anything, you know, that I can't stop. And I can't go 6 days without this thing. God wants to get involved in your battle. Maybe you can't do it alone, and it's frightening even to think, because maybe you've even tried about it. But listen, God wants to get involved in your battle. Romans chapter 6 says, do not let sin reign. Like, don't let it be in charge of your mortal body so that you obey its evil desires. Don't offer the parts of your body to sin as instruments of wickedness, but rather offer yourselves to God. And I love this last line. I hope that this is just, you let the, hold on to this one. Let it ring true in your hearts today. For sin shall not be my master. Sin will is not going to be my master. I want to encourage you this week to think of that area that you say, you know what, this is difficult for me. And by the way, I have an area that God has just revealed to me. And it's not necessarily a sin area, but if I let it come too close into my life, too much of it, I just wish I didn't have too much of an area in my life and I need to distance myself from it. And so I'm being challenged by this, saying, no, I need to push that away because nothing's going to master me. I'm not going to let anything become an addiction and master me. Okay, let's take it up a notch from there, you guys. Here's the second toxin in our body, and that is debauchery. What in the world is that, Pastor? That's debauchery. What is that word? The reason why I gave you that fancy word is because that's the word that the scriptures actually use, debauchery. Jason, what's debauchery? Debauchery is basically where your senses call the shots. It's letting your senses call the shots in your life. The actual definition is extreme indulgence in sensuality. Extreme indulgence in sensuality. So I really want to address this and confront this head on. And I want to be very plain about this. And this probably affects those of you who are 30 years old and younger than those of you in here today that are 30 years old and above that age. Because if you're 30 years and or older, a lot of you that are 30 years and older, you were raised with some moral absolutes. You were raised with some convictions. Many of you were raised in, like I was, in a generation where the government even got involved and told you, no, you don't need to, you should live according to your convictions, not according to your feelings. So I was raised during the Reagan years, and Nancy Reagan came out with a whole bunch of programs, the anti-drug program, anti-gang program, and then eventually there was even an anti-premarital sex, just nationwide program that did it, which was the mantra for that was, just say, how many know it? Just say no. Yeah, so just say no. There was this, we were raised in a generation where they told us, you can come face to face with some things that you feel like doing, but it's at that moment that your moral absolutes should take over. And you don't have to do what you feel like doing. You can actually be led not by your feelings, but by your principles, by your convictions, by the Word of God. You can be led by Christ, not by your feelings. Well, that's not the mantra of today, is it? They're not even asking you to do that. Today's mantra is just be yourself. Just be you. And if that's what you feel with, and that's who you are, just go with it. And I'll tell you, especially young people that I love and care for you so much, don't buy into the theology of today. Don't buy into if you feel it, that's your life trying to speak to you. It's your life telling you what's true for you. Get out of here. You can't be led by your feelings. Look, if I was led by my feelings all the time, I probably would be in jail. You know what I'm saying? I would not be your pastor, that's for sure. If I was led by my feelings all the time, it just would not happen. There's like you can let your choices lead you and your feelings follow. Like your those moral absolutes, those convictions. And so debauchery comes along and says, hey, your feelings can be trusted. No, they can't. You cannot trust your feelings. And I'll tell you very clearly that we live in a debaucherous society. A society that is just drunk on their senses and just trust your feelings. No. That's why some of the things that we put in our bodies can create this. Look at Ephesians chapter 5:18. It says, do not get drunk on wine, which leads to this overindulgence of our sin. It leads to debauchery. So in other words, be careful even what you consume, both in your body, your eyes, your ears. Be careful what you're putting in, because it'll lead to this lifestyle, this debaucherous. And you guys have seen this, where people get like drunk, or they get some toxic substance, or they smoke something, and they just act dumb. You know what I mean? They say dumb things. They lose all inhibitions. He's saying, don't dull your senses with that stuff of the world. Now it could be some of those toxins but it could be anything you put in your eyes, anything you put in your ears. Just don't dull the senses that lead to this thing called debauchery. The Bible says, look, don't do that, because it's going to lead to something that it'll ultimately destroy your life. Instead, he says, be filled with the Spirit. Like instead of getting so close to the world and getting your senses dull, like draw away from that and get close to the Spirit of God. Like some of us are, we are so close to the world, to the culture of the world. We know what's going on, don't we? We know what's going on in the news. We know what's going on in politics. We know what's going on in Hollywood scene. We know when words come in and out of season, like when Fleet came popular and Fleet was no longer popular. And now we're saying, like some of you are so close to, like you know the culture of the world so much. Just listen, hang in. Listen, what would happen if we just distance ourselves from the culture of this world and got a little bit closer to the culture of the kingdom of heaven? You know there's a culture of the Spirit? That what is the Spirit of God saying to society? In the kingdom of heaven is this invisible realm that is running parallel to the culture of this world. Like, what would happen if we just stopped dulling our senses with the culture of this world and knowing everything, the ins and outs of the world, and we pulled away, just separated ourselves a little bit, and we're filled with the Spirit? Man, I'm telling you, you would hear from God. You would hear from God. You would know what's happening and what's popular and where he's moving and where you need to lay hands and where you need to pull back because the culture of heaven is leading you. Amen, Pastor. Dang, that's some good stuff. Okay, let me bring this up again. Let me take another notch here. Okay, here's the third toxin of our body, and that is sexual immorality. Sexual, and again, this is the term actually used in Scripture, and the Bible is very vocal on this subject. It really is. I think that there's a lot of people in our society today that don't know what sexual immorality is. So let me explain what, because in the English language we get two words. We get sexual immorality, but in the Greek language, where this was the Bible was the original language of the New Testament, the Greek for this word is porneia. Porneia, which is where we get our English word pornography, but it doesn't mean pornography. Porneia means all sexual sin outside of marriage. All. And marriage, by the way, defined by God, not by government. Okay? So, and I'm not, and I like let government decide what they want to decide, but you cannot unwrite what God has already written. Okay? And that's not to pick on any group, because that confronts all of us, doesn't it? It's all sin, all sexual sin, outside of the bond of marriage. That's lust, that's pornography, that is cohabiting, that's premarital sex, hetero or homosexual. It's all of it. All of us need to know that all sex outside of marriage is toxic. It destroys us. And the question is, why? Like, what does it matter? What does it matter, Jason? Two consenting adults, they ain't hurting nobody. Just loving each other. What does it matter? I mean, I was alone when I looked at this. You know, what does it matter? I was by myself. I wasn't hurting anybody. I mean, what's the problem? Well, 1 Corinthians chapter 6 gives us the reason why this is a problem. And by the way, Paul wrote to the Corinthian church who, these people were living in a country where they worshiped their idol by going to church and having sex with prostitutes in the church. That's what they did. That's how they worshiped in Corinth, in this country. They would. So imagine that. Just imagine that they go to church and have sex with a prostitute to worship their God. So Paul comes along and says, man, you obviously don't know some things. Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ himself? What? Oh, yeah, he doesn't dwell in buildings. He dwells in people. Oh, really? Yeah. You're the temple. He wanted to dwell inside of you. Shall I then take the members of Christ and this is a key word, it won't shock you, but it shocked them, and unite them with a prostitute? To which they would say, unite? What? Because the word in Greek for unite means to fuse at the deepest level possible. So that's the word, unite. It's not just an act of sexuality itself. It meant what you probably didn't know is there's something way more than the physical act happening. There's something being fused at the deepest level in your soul when you do this, which, by the way, is what the world wants you to think. The world wants you to think, oh, that's an isolated event. Oh, it's just recreational. It's no big deal. I mean, hey, Jason, it was spring break, you know. It was spring break. I didn't know the girl. I don't even know her name. I didn't know her name. You know, it was spring break. You know, I didn't really unite. I didn't fuse with her. No. Listen, what you didn't know is that she left a part of her on you. And you left a part of you on her. A fusing took place. Do you not know that he who unites, who permanently fuses themselves at the deepest level, unites himself with a prostitute, is one with her? And he's not talking about the physical oneness. He's talking about something that God put into sexuality. Like God put it there. He designed sexuality to be this way. And that is that there would be this soul bond. And by the way, for those of you married people, God put it there for you. So he knew that this experience of sex would help to increase the strength and the bond of marriage, of matrimony, of husband and wife. It's there to increase the intimacy and the unity of marriage. Which by the way, married couples, that's why it's so important for you to have a healthy sex life. So that you guys can continue to be fused and walk into the bond, your souls being bonded together. He's one with her in body, for it is said, and he quotes this Old Testament verse, the first verse about sex. For it is said, the two shall become one flesh. And again, he's not talking about the physical. He's talking about an emotional oneness that's happening there. Which, if some of you are thinking, well, I don't know if there's like a, it's not really emotional to me. If you don't think this is an emotional act and it's just physical, ask someone who's been raped or abused. Ask someone who's been raped or abused if it was more than physical. They'll tell you, no, it was deeply emotional. It was. Well, that doesn't sound very encouraging right there, does it? Because for most of us, knowing, some of us unknowing, have kind of stepped into some of this and engaged, and maybe even currently engaged in, some are permanently fusing with their computer screen. Some of us are having soul ties happening in a lot of different ways. So what do we do about that? The good news is that the Bible always gives us a solution, is that God always provides us with the answer, with the solution. And God is always willing to give you a fresh start if you trust Him and follow Him. Can I hear a good amen? Amen. You can detox. And when God gets involved, He doesn't just forgive, He cleanses. And there's a big difference, you guys. So God just doesn't like cover your sin. No, the Bible says He cleanses your sin. He washes it away. And as far as the east is from the west, He doesn't even remember it no more. That is good news for you today. So how do we detox the body? 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 4. Each of you should learn. So we got to learn how to control our own body. So God gets involved, and there is a supernatural process of cleansing that happens. But now you just need to be taught some things, and that's where my job comes in, where I can hopefully show you easy, life-giving ways, healthy ways, ways that aren't restricting or painful, but that God has life-giving ways for you out of that situation. How many guys know that God is not against you? God is for you. And everything in His Word is not for Him, and it was not to restrict you. It is there for you to experience life and life abundantly. Okay? So how do we do it? How do we learn to control our body in a way that is, He says, holy? And holy doesn't mean perfect. It just means that separation thing, to be separated for God. Holy and honorable, not like the rest of the world just following their passions, people that just don't know, they don't know God. We got to learn how. So there's a lot of things I could have given you. There is every week a lot of things, but let me give you three things today. I want to just give you three that will be a blessing for you this week that you apply today to your life. You'll experience some freedom in a new way. Okay, write these down. Number one, if we want a body detox, here's the first step. Just get away from it. Just get away from it. Just physically get away. Physically move yourself from your proximity of that thing and the closeness you are to that thing. Just get away from it. Well, what it? Your it. Whatever your it is. Whatever your it is, get away from it. So it could be a person or relationship that has become way too flirtatious, and you know it. You know it's going, and you're right there on the edge of the cliff, and you know it. We work together. Find a new job. It's not worth your soul. It's not worth your marriage. It's not worth all the relationships. It's not worth it. It's not worth it. The grass is not greener on the other side. The grass is greener wherever you water it, okay? You need to text, like today, text that person. It's over. It's over. And then block them, okay? Block them, erase it. Whatever you got to do, just get away from it. Look what the Bible says, 1 Corinthians chapter 6. It says, flee, run from sexual immoralities. Let me say it this way. You don't manage sin, you run away from it. Some people say, well, Pastor, I'm working on that. No, you don't work on it. You get away from it. Don't work on this issue. Just get away. Run. Run away. Get away from it. That's what you need to do. Cut the ties, whatever it takes. I know I'm touching on some areas that are hard, you guys, but I want you to experience a new level of freedom, okay? I want you walking in everything God has for you, and you maybe in the Holy Spirit showing you the areas that keep tripping you up from experiencing God's best. And I want God's best for your life. All other sins, he says. Like, the other sins are bad, but they're not like this one. All the other sins a man commits are outside his body, but he who sins sexually sins against his own body. Like, we're hurting ourselves with this one. Do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you've received from God? You are not your own. You were bought with a price. Therefore, honor God with your body. Now, I realize that some of you here today, that you're not Christ followers. And I'm glad you're here. And I hope that you feel free to just experience this thing and check out Jesus and church. And I hope you feel free to. But some of this stuff, I know you might be thinking like, what? I don't think so. I'm going to do what I want. You know, I have the right to do what I want. And so what you may not realize is like, yes, you have that right. But Christ followers don't have that right. Like, I don't have that right. I gave up my rights a long time ago. See, what you may not realize if you're not a Christ follower here today, what you may not realize is I took a deal with God a long time ago. And the deal was, God told me that because of my sin and my separation from Him, the penalty of that was just death, an eternal death in hell. And hell's not a place where God sends bad people. Hell's a place for people to pay for their sins themselves. We choose it. And so God told me, you can choose that. That's or I have a way out for you. And the way out is this, and this is the only way, that you would accept my Son, give Him the control of your life, Jesus. And what He paid for your sins, that all I'm asking for is, in return, is your life. Is surrender it. Like, don't live your life for you and for what you want. You live your life for me. And I took that deal. I took it. Because what's cool about this deal is that God wants what's best for my life. He's the author. He's the beginning and the end. He knows. And He wants what's best for me. And He can do so much better with the control of my life than I can with the control of my life. So I am not my own. I was bought with a price. I don't have the right to do what I don't have the right to pick and choose what parts of the Bible. I don't have the right to do maybe what you have the right. I've been bought. What price? What? The cross. The cross bought me. And so I don't have to pay for my sins anymore. God, they are fully paid for. They've all been paid for. Okay, that's good news. Here's the second thing, and that is you can't get away from the fact that you're going to have to, if you want to remove these body toxins, you're going to have to guard your mind. Guard your mind. The battle always begins, you guys, in the mind. And how many of you ever been... You watched a movie a long time ago, and you thought it was a good movie. You're like, oh, I remember that movie, and you have good memories about that movie. It's like, yeah, it's a great movie, you know. And you go back to watch that movie, and you're like, oh my goodness, this is terrible. You know what I'm talking about? I had this happen to me recently. It was Risky Business, and I was like, Risky Business, you know, Risky Business. And I went back to watch it. I said, oh my goodness, I had to turn it off. There was just so much foul language and so much sexuality, and I'm like, because what happened between all this time was there was sanctification that happened. And God just more and more started separating me, and I thought these things were funny and good. And so what you hear a lot of today is like, oh, it's not really that bad. There's just that one part in it. There's just that one part. And it's real quick. It's real quick. And if you wonder why we're so desensitized, it's because of the things we're letting in our life. We're letting in our eyes, we're letting in our ears. Oh man, it's a great song, it's such a good song, so inspiring. It just has maybe just a few words. If you get by those words though, man, it's such a good song. Oh, it's a good movie. But it has a few parts. It's just real quick, though, and which reminds me of a story of this kid, this boy, who went up to his mom. And he's like, "Mom, I want to have my friends over. And can I please invite them over and watch this movie? And this movie, it's rated this, but Mom, it's just real quick. It's a quick part. It's not really that big a deal. It's over quick. And most of my friends have already seen it. They've already seen it. Most of them. Please, Mom, I want to have my friends over. I want to watch this movie. Can we do that, Mom?" And Mom's like, "Okay, fine." He's like, "Really? Really, Mom, we can do that? I can invite them over and watch this movie?" She said, Yeah, I'll even bake your favorite brownies. I'll bake them." He said, "Really, Mom? Thank you so much." And so he invites his friends over. They're in the living room. They're watching the movie. And Mom goes in the kitchen. She starts baking the brownies and checking on the kids and stuff. And she runs to the backyard. And she goes to where the Dotson leaves his business. You know what I mean? And so she takes a little piece of that. And she gets that little piece and come put it in that batter. And she bakes those brownies, and she comes in. "Here you guys go. Here you go, boys." And there they are. There are the brownies. "Oh, thank you, Mom. Thank you. Oh, and by the way, it's just a little piece, though. Just a little piece. And you're probably not even going to taste it. It's not that big a deal. It still tastes good. It doesn't affect it. You're not even going to realize it's there, but just a little piece." How many of you know a little poop goes a long way? Huh? You didn't think I'd go there, did you? I'm serious, you guys. We're letting stuff in to our bodies, and we're thinking like, no wonder I keep living the way I'm living. No wonder I keep choosing the things I don't want to choose. No wonder my mind keeps keeping me prisoner of these things. I ain't eating the brownie. Come on, somebody. I'm not eating the brownie. We get desensitized to these things. I'm serious about this stuff, you guys, and why we're... just one part. Oh, it's just one part. It's just a little piece. Look, all the devil needs is one piece. All the devil needs is just a little one opening, one part. That's all he needs. Look at Matthew chapter 6. Jesus says that the eye is the lamp of the body. The eye, like what is coming in the eye. If your eyes are good, if what's coming in there is good, yeah, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eyes are bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. Where are you losing the battle of your mind? Where are you losing the battle of the eye gate? Where are you letting in? What are you seeing? What are you entertaining? Because Romans chapter 8, verse 5 says, those who are dominated by the sinful nature, this is what the problem is. They're thinking about sinful things. But those who are controlled by the Holy Spirit, they think about things that please the Spirit. So you ever see some people that just like, man, they're on fire for God, serving God, loving God, and just like fruit in their life, and you say, man, they're not better than you. They just think different from you. They just have different thinking. They think about what the Spirit desires, and so what is manifested in their life is Spirit fruit. Guard your mind. 6 days, detox. Come on, everybody. Here's the last one. And this one is what I'm most passionate about when it comes to preaching. My style of preaching really is not like, and God doesn't do this either, like don't, no, stop it, stop, no, amen, go do that. No, that's not, I don't do that. And that's not how God treats us either, by the way. God doesn't just show us what not to do. God gives us a better alternative. That's what he does. So let me say it this way. Sin will lose its attractiveness whenever you find something else better. And that's why I want to encourage you and not like slap your wrist all the time. No, the reason why I don't commit adultery is not because there's a verse in the Bible telling me not to do it. The reason why I don't commit adultery is because I love Veronica. I love her. I love my wife. So I'm not having to force myself to do something because I'm in love. I want to draw your heart to something greater, to something that you love. And I think once you find something better than sin, that it will lose its attractiveness in your life. And that's why the real solution to detoxing your body is this. Write this down. You need to go all in with God. Go all in with God. Some of you got a little toe in. Some of you got a little hand in. Some of you got God tucked into your week, just tucked in perfectly into your Sunday, right there in your week. But don't you bring God to my office. Don't you bring God into this part of my life. You need to go all in with God if you're serious about detoxing and aligning your life to God's will. You want to know why sin does not master me? I'll give you two reasons. One, I'm too consumed with the purpose for my life and the mission of God. I'm just too caught up in God's business and work for me, like my purpose and mission. I ain't got time for all that. That stuff ain't worth what God has for me. And secondly, you want to know one of the reasons why I'm not mastered by sin? Is you. You. Like I live my life to be an example for you. Now don't put me on a pedestal, because I mess up from time to time. Not purposefully, but I do, because I am human, but I'm so motivated more than just the do's and don'ts, and you gotta not do this, Jason. Don't do this. No, I'm motivated by something greater. I'm motivated by you. It's the same thing for my kids. I'm motivated by my children. I want to be a godly man for them. I want to be an example for them. I want them to, my daughter, Abigail, she told me just a couple weeks ago, she said, Dad, how do you control yourself the way you do when people are being mean or mad and difficult? How do you do that? And I was able to just to tell her, it's because of you, honey. It's because God's calling on my life. It's because God has greater for me. That's why I cannot be mastered by sin. I have something greater. I just believe that when you can have a purpose in your life that is greater, sin will lose its attractiveness. It'll lose its grip on you. I'll show you a verse. Watch this. Romans chapter 6, verse 13. Do not let any part of your body become an instrument of evil to serve sin. Instead, so here's a better way. Give yourself completely to God. Like, you want the solution? You want the solution to this whole thing? Man, go all in with God and just see what He does with your life. Come on, let's bow our heads and close our eyes together.